My name is Pastor Ben, and I am the pastor of Gibraltar Bible Baptist Church here in Gibraltar, Michigan. Thank you so much for taking the time once again to join us for our online Bible study as we open the Word of God together and study God's Word, the Bible. This is actually a very special Easter edition of our online Bible study, and I'd like to present some truths from the Word of God today that pertain to the resurrection of Jesus Christ from the grave. So would you please take your Bible and turn with me to the Gospel of John, John chapter 20, and we would like to look today at the first nine verses of John chapter 20, verses 1 through 9. Now, in our last Bible study together, we considered the dark hour of Jesus Christ on the cross that appeared to be the cross of death, destruction, and defeat, but actually became the cross of eternal triumph. And in that Bible study, we looked at the account of the crucifixion as it was told by the Apostle John in John chapter 19. Now, the companion text to John 19 is John chapter 20, the moment when Jesus Christ, in one moment forever, exited the tomb for good. So in John chapter 20, the Apostle John invites us to come to the tomb. That's the title of our Bible study together, as you'll see behind me, Come to the Tomb. The Apostle John is writing down these events regarding the resurrection for a very specific purpose. Please understand John's intent, as he himself states explicitly at the end of John chapter 20. And here's John's purpose. Biblical faith is not divorced from reason and evidence. As we consider this text, we understand that John is actually providing a factual and evidential basis for the resurrection. John is writing his gospel to the world at large, so he is adding the necessary details to convince a largely skeptical audience of the truth claims of the resurrection. It has been said that extraordinary claims require extraordinary evidence, and that is exactly what we discover in this resurrection text today in John chapter 20, extraordinary evidence for an extraordinary event. The big idea in our Bible study today is taken directly from the text, John chapter 20, verse 31. John gives us his own big idea, and that is this: these things are written that you may believe that Jesus is the Christ, the Son of God, and that believing you may have life through his name. I'd like to invite you to open your Bibles with me, please, to John chapter 20, and follow along as we read and study the Word of God. In particular, I'd like to look at John's timeline as he lays out three important moments in the resurrection narrative for us to consider. We're going to look today, as we study the Word of God, at three moments in the resurrection narrative. First of all, we find in verses 1 and 2, first to arrive. First to arrive. The Bible tells us in John 20, verses 1 and 2, now on the first day of the week, Mary Magdalene went to the tomb early while it was still dark and saw that the stone had been taken away from the tomb. Then she ran and came to Simon Peter and to the other disciple whom Jesus loved. And she said to them, "They have taken away the Lord out of the tomb, and we do not know where they have laid him." So here in verse 1, John begins with the time frame. The events that were about to unfold took place on the first day of the week. Please remember, as we saw in our last Bible study in John chapter 19, that Jesus had been crucified and buried a few days prior. He was buried in the garden tomb, which was located pretty close to the place where he was crucified. So Golgotha and the garden tomb are not very far from one another. Furthermore, the Bible tells us that Jesus was in the darkness of the tomb for 3 days and 3 nights. As a matter of fact, this period of time, 3 days and three nights in the tomb, were very important to establish the absolute reality of death. After the amount of abuse that Jesus had endured before the cross, with the beatings and the whippings and the scourgings and the sleeplessness and so forth, the abuse he endured before he even went to the cross, in addition, the amount of time that Jesus spent nailed to the cross, and the fact that he had a spear plunged into his side at the end of his time on the cross, and there gushed out blood and water, and he was truly dead. There was no possible way that Jesus could have merely fainted and then by himself revived 3 days later, devoid of food, water, and medical care, yet strong enough to push open the large stone door of the tomb, not to mention strong enough to break out of his own burial shroud, push open the stone door of the tomb, which was too large for the women at the tomb to open by themselves. That was a concern of theirs. This stone is too big for us to move. So the weakened, abused Jesus hardly would have had the strength after 3 days and three nights of being tied up literally in the tomb, without food, without water, without medical attention, to push his way through the door, which was not only affixed in place but bound by a chain, not to mention fight his way through the four sturdy Roman soldiers that were guarding the door of the tomb and then make his escape. It's really unthinkable and totally irrational to assume that Jesus had merely fainted on the cross, as some people have postulated, and now he is revived and makes his own way from the tomb. Really, the three-day period establishes the fact that Jesus was truly dead. So the first day of the week here in John chapter 20, verse 1, establishes the biblical timeline. And the early morning establishes Mary Magdalene's loyalty and eagerness to honor her Lord. Please understand that Mary Magdalene was one of Jesus' most loyal followers. She was at the cross in John chapter 19, verse 25. As Jesus was being crucified, Mary Magdalene was at the cross looking up at her dying Savior, and now she is the first to the tomb. It was the first thing in the morning, and it was the first thing at the end of the Sabbath, which was sunup on Sunday morning. So all of these facts point to her eager devotion to her Lord. Now, when Mary arrived at the tomb in verse 1, she saw in the gloomy light of fading night that the stone was missing from the door of the tomb. Whatever else Mary Magdalene may have done at the tomb as she saw that the stone was rolled away, there's some other accounts, resurrection accounts of Matthew, Mark, and Luke all include Mary Magdalene, and perhaps she did according to those other gospels. Maybe Mary did some other things while she was at the tomb. But the Apostle John doesn't tell us about anything else that Mary did. She merely saw that the stone was rolled away from the door of the tomb, and then she turned and ran. That's John's emphasis of Mary's behavior. She stood in shock at the empty tomb, the open door, and then she turned and ran. Now, the Bible tells us in verse 2 that she ran looking for Peter. Of course, Peter was one of Jesus' most trusted associates. She ran looking for Peter, but she found Peter with another disciple on their way to the tomb. Now, this other disciple is not named. He carries a cryptic title here. He's called the disciple whom Jesus loved. This title is used a number of other times throughout the Gospel of John. We're not going to identify this man other than simply to say he is the Apostle John himself. There's a lot of evidence and a lot of discussion about that title, which we'll not enter into for sake of time. So Mary runs away from the tomb. She's looking for Peter. She bumps into Peter with the Apostle John. And now what Mary says to these two men is very important. Mary says in verse 2, "They have taken away the Lord out of the tomb, and we do not know where they have laid him." Mary assumes that she knows what has happened. She assumes that the body of Christ has been stolen. Of course, in her mind, he is, of course, still dead. And she says, someone, I don't know who, has taken the Lord's body. And of course, they must have put the Lord's body somewhere else. So in verse 2, we have a window into the mind of Mary in these moments as she's running frantically from the tomb. We're given a little bit of insight into how she's thinking. She assumes she knows what has happened, but she's flabbergasted. We see that Mary felt a strong sense of urgency in that she ran to Peter and John. And now they share her urgency, and that they, in response, run with her back to the tomb in verse 4. So the first few verses of John chapter 20, this resurrection narrative, are serving to heighten our sense of the mysteriousness and the urgency of what is taking place. The darkness, the sudden shock at the stone being rolled away from the door of the tomb, and now all of the running. What is going on? So we see, first of all, in verses 1 and 2, first to arrive. That leads us, secondly, to verses 3 through 7, first to see. First to see. The Bible tells us in verses 3 and following, Peter therefore went out and the other disciple and were going to the tomb. So they both ran together, and the other disciple outran Peter and came to the tomb first. And he, stooping down and looking in, saw the linen cloths lying there, yet he did not go in. Then Simon Peter came following him and went into the tomb, and he saw the linen cloths lying there and the handkerchief that had been around his head, not lying with the linen cloths, but folded together in a place by itself. So going back to verse 3, Peter and John do not take the time to discuss these circumstances with Mary. Mary comes running up to them, panting, red-faced, probably trickling a little bit and glistening with a little bit of sweat. And she blurts out that the body of the Lord is missing. And of course, Peter and John are overwhelmed with their own sense of shock. And so they don't talk to Mary about what she saw. They just run straight to the tomb to see for themselves. Previously, they were walking slowly and mournfully, and now they are running. Now, in verses 4 and 5, we see the personalities and responses of these two disciples being contrasted with one another. Certainly, the Apostle Peter and the Apostle John are two very different people, and we see that on display here. John is faster, but Peter is bolder. John arrived first at the door of the tomb and peeked into the tomb from just outside the door. As he did, he saw a couple of things. The Bible tells us in verse 5 what John, the other disciple, the beloved disciple, what he saw as he looked in. Stooping down, he looked in. He saw the linen cloths lying there, but he did not go in. So John saw two things as he looked into the tomb. First of all, he saw that the tomb was empty. And this was a very significant thing by itself. But secondly, John saw that the swaddling clothes were also empty. And this was very significant. And in some ways, this is even more significant than the empty tomb itself. Now, in preparation for burial, as was the custom of the day, and in the harmony of the Gospels, we see in the other Gospels, and even in John's Gospel, some description of the preparation of Jesus' body for burial. So the preparation included wrapping the body in long strips of cloth, which is called swaddling clothes. And incidentally, of course, when we say swaddling clothes, we always tend to think of Jesus' birth. He was wrapped in swaddling clothes, and that was somewhat of a common thing, both at a child's birth and also at a person's death. And so that's what we have here, both at Jesus' birth and at his death. He's wrapped in these swaddling clothes. Now, there's different kinds of wrappings, burial wrappings, in a Jewish custom, in Middle Eastern custom. There was perhaps, you know, one big piece of cloth, but in this case, probably, Jesus was wrapped in long strips of cloth, so that after he had been prepared for burial, wrapped in these spices and in these long strips of cloth, he would have looked like what we picture an Egyptian mummy. And so he had been bound in these long strips of cloth and laid in the tomb. So Jesus, having been bound, you know, you can imagine perhaps any number of reasons why grave robbers would have broken into a tomb and stolen the body. I mean, we can you know, conjure up a lot of reasons why the body would have been stolen out of the tomb. That did happen. But it's unthinkable that a body would have been removed from the burial cloths and that they would have been left behind in the tomb while the body was being stolen. So there's something very unusual taking place here. So as we trace the trajectory of the text, we see here, going back to verse 1, that Mary was the first to arrive, but John was the first to see. However, John did not go into the tomb, so for this reason, he was very limited in what he saw. Now we see in verse 6 that Simon Peter arrived second, but he entered first. The Bible says Simon Peter came and following him, went into the tomb and he saw the linen cloths lying there. So with Peter's typical brashness, he pushed his way inside and stared about the tomb. Verse 6 tells us what Peter saw as he entered the tomb and looked around. And to this point, Peter is seeing all the same things that John saw from the outside. Peter's seeing the same things now from the inside. But in verse 7, and the handkerchief that had been around his head, not lying with the linen cloths, but folded together in a place by itself. So Peter, in verse 7, because he went into the tomb, now he's able to observe one additional detail. The head wrap, the napkin, folded separately from the swaddling clothes. So why is John giving us all of these details? Well, really, John is pointing out the obvious. These are not the behaviors of malevolent grave robbers. Rather, these are measured, thoughtful, time-consuming behaviors to carefully unwrap the body completely and neatly fold the clothes nearby. As Colin Cruz says, clearly the body of Jesus had not been stolen by his enemies or removed by his friends. In either case, the linen strips and burial cloth would not have been removed at the tomb, as the removal of the body would have been carried out in haste so as not to be observed. So the Apostle John is laying out the facts to one irrefutable conclusion. The body of Jesus is missing, but in the most unusual way. The event that has taken place is not natural, but supernatural. So we see, first of all, first to arrive, secondly, first to see. And that brings us to verses 8 and 9 in our final point in our study, the final event in John's timeline. Number 3, verses 8 and 9, first to believe. Look with me, please, at verses 8 and 9. Then the other disciple who came to the tomb first went in also, and he saw and believed. For as yet they did not know the scripture that he must rise again from the dead. We come to the pinnacle of the text. Now the other disciple, whom we have identified as John, also enters the tomb with Peter. And now John sees the fuller picture the way that Peter did. When Peter went into the tomb, he saw the whole picture. And now John joins him, and John sees the big picture as well. That the swaddling cloths and the head napkin have been carefully removed and folded and set neatly nearby. John understands that this can mean only one thing. Although Peter is the first to enter, John is the first to believe. But what did John believe? John was beginning to grasp the central truth to the Gospel of John. What he said in verse 31 of the same chapter, "These things are written that you may believe that Jesus is the Christ, the Son of God, and that believing you may have life through his name." The entire Gospel of John is written to engender belief. We see that in chapter 14 and again in chapter 21. And now John is leading the way in faith. I love the words of F.F. Bruce. When the beloved disciple, he says, followed Peter into the tomb, he saw what Peter had seen, but with the eye of faith, he saw more. Like a flash, it came home to him what had happened. So as we are studying John 20 verses 1 through 9, we are seeing the pattern in the text. At the beginning, Mary Magdalene saw just a little. Then John saw just a little more. Then Peter saw fully, but did not yet understand and believe. And now finally, John sees fully and believes. This pattern is deliberate in John chapter 20 of seeing and believing, seeing a little bit more, not fully understanding, seeing a little bit more, and finally believing. And actually, this pattern reaches its deliberate crescendo at the end of John chapter 20. With the example of doubting Thomas, who did not see or believe, but later on did see and believe. This is an incredibly powerful message to a worldwide audience who would not have the privilege of seeing the risen Savior firsthand, but are now given profound evidence via the written word. Those who, having not seen, yet believe. And verse 9 wraps all of these truths up beautifully for us, as John says, "For as yet they did not know the scripture that he must rise again from the dead." John 20 verses 1 through 9 is a resurrection text and a resurrection truth. No one had stolen the body. It is absurd to think that they can or would. All of the evidence points powerfully in one direction. Jesus had foretold his own crucifixion and resurrection, and he fulfilled his word completely. I look at John chapter 20, and I think that the pattern that the Apostle John is laying out for us and the picture that he's painting for us is profound, because what John is describing, starting in verse 1 and carrying on through the end of John chapter 20, is the process of faith in the mind and heart of the doubter. John understands very well that his audience, whether those who hear or read his gospel, his unbelieving audience is prone to skepticism. We don't believe the supernatural lightly. We assume that those sorts of claims are false. And so John is painting a picture both of the resurrection, but also of the process of faith, where he says, you know, beginning in verse 1 with Mary, she's creeping through the dark. She discovers a tomb that's empty, apparently. It blows her mind. The stone should not be missing. Jesus' body should still be there, but it's not. And so she runs. She's not able to wrap her head around these truths. The light is starting to shine. The sun comes up. Little by little, it was dark, and now the light is starting to be shed on the situation. Peter and John have the same response as Mary Magdalene. They run to the tomb. We have to see this for ourselves. We don't believe at first. We have to see it to believe it. And finally, they accept by faith that Jesus has been resurrected. Later on at the end of the chapter, we have the same process once again with doubting Thomas. All the other disciples say, "We've seen the Lord." Thomas says, "Well, unless I see it with my own eyes, I'm not going to believe." Later on, Jesus meets with Thomas personally. "Thomas, here's my hands. Look at my feet. You can feel the holes where the nails were pounded into the cross through my wrist. Put your finger in. Feel it. Feel the hole in my side where the spear plunged into my heart." Thomas says, "My Lord and my God." John is showing us the process of faith. That at first we come face to face with the truth claims of the Lord Jesus Christ. At first, in the mind, the heart of the doubter and the skeptic, you know, there's doubt. This can't possibly be true. But as we are continually confronted and we continually thoughtfully, prayerfully consider the claims of Jesus Christ, we come face to face with the fact and the truth that he is indeed the divine Son of God, crucified for the sins of man, For 3 days, he lay dead in the tomb. But on the third day, on Sunday, then came the morning, and he rose up from the grave. This is indeed the divine Son of God, crucified, put to death, bleeding for our sins, and raised for our justification. So in conclusion, I would like to share three brief truths with you. First of all, Christianity is a religion of reason. Reason and intellect and thinking. There is tremendous evidence for the truth claims of the Christian faith, most specifically, the resurrection event. Though it is a very unexpected event, yet we have in John's Gospels and in the other Gospels trustworthy testimony to its truth. The testimony of the Gospel writers stands up to careful scrutiny. Secondly, Christianity is a religion of faith. Many claims in the Bible transcend reason alone. This is why the author of Hebrews tells us that without faith, it is impossible to believe and please God. We are called to obey the words of Jesus to doubting Thomas in John 20, verse 29, where Jesus said, "Blessed are those who have not seen and have yet believed." And finally, Christianity is a religion of life, not death. We place our hope in a Savior who is alive, not dead, and who thus leads us into life. Because it is a religion of life, it governs our lives from beginning to end, to the very moment of death, and even beyond into eternal life, the very presence of God Himself. And so I'd like to invite you, with the Apostle John, come to the tomb with me. Find the tomb empty and discover in its place a living Savior, our hope for eternal life.